Hello guys, welcome to episode 5 of our NIST Access Control Explanation series. In this episode, we are going to go over the AC-5, that is the separation of duties control. But as always, please consider subscribing to the channel to help the channel grow. And also do smash the like button and the notification bell to get notified whenever I upload new videos. Thank you and let's get started. Separation of duties, SOD, refer to the principle that no user should be given more than enough privileges to misuse the system on their own. It is sometimes called the segregation of duties. It is basically a concept that calls for having more than one person complete an entire sensitive mission, task, or process. That is, you should not have one person go through the entire mission, sensitive task, or process by him or herself. It has to be a separation of duty that two or three people or even more, otherwise one person might be tempted to kind of misuse the privilege and cause damage to the organization. For example, when you go to the bank and you're trying to withdraw a large sum of money, you notice that when the cashier counts the money, she will call a second cashier or a manager to count the money. These are all controls in place to make sure one person does not abuse the system. For example, if you are in charge of account payables, you should not be in charge of the payment authorization. If you work with vendors and you're in charge of what account payables for the vendors, you should not be also in charge of authorizing the payments. Separation of duties is critical to effective internal control because it reduces the risk of both erroneous and inappropriate action. Now, let's look at the control requirement as stated in the Special Publication 853, Revision 5. AC-5, Separation of Duties. The control requirement, A, identify and document assignment, organization defined duties of individual requiring separation. So first of all, the organization have to come up with a separation of duty metrics, you know, how they document the activities that cannot be combined together. If they don't have a SOD metrics, then implementing this control might be a bit challenging. So therefore, they have to identify what activities or what processes should not be combined or assigned to a single person in order not to allow that person having a lot of leverage to cause a potential damage. So once the organization identifies those activities, then they separate these activities. These activities will not be given or will not be the responsibility of a single employee or a staff within the organization. Then after that, B, define system access authorization to support separation of duty. You have to define the access authorization. You know, how do you give access to, or how do you give authorization to the employees? That would be kind of tied to the AC2, right? So everything will be in the account management process, how they assign the level of privileges that each individual should have. That will be determined in the account management process. All right, so now let's look at the discussion. Separation of duties addresses the potential for abuse of authorized privileges and helps to reduce the risk of malevolent activity without collision. Separation of duties include dividing mission or business functions and support functions among different individuals or roles, conducting system support function with different individuals, and ensuring that security personnel who administer access control functions do not also administer audit function. So you see that? If the system admins who are in charge of creating the account are also in charge of administering the audit functions, they may feel so powerful to create a fictitious account or a malicious account, do something bad with it, go into the audit logs and delete those accounts or delete the audit logs in reference to the account after they've deleted, or they might have deleted the malicious account that they created. So meaning that there will be no traces of whatever they use that malicious account for. So therefore, when you or when an admin is in charge of creating an account, he should not be in charge of what administering the audit functions. All right, moving on. Because separation of duties violation can span systems and application domains, organizations consider the entirety of systems and system component when developing a policy on separation of duties. Separation of duties is enforced through the account management activity in AC-2, access control mechanism in AC-3, and identity management activity in IA-2, IA-4, and IA-12. So like I said, the AC-2 is a very, very, you know, key control in enforcing the AC-5. Some of the related controls here are what? AC-2, of course, AC-3, AC-6, AU-9, CM-11, CP-9, IA-2, IA-4, IA-5, IA-12, MA-3, MA-5, PS-2, SA-8, SA-17. But this control here does not have any enhancement. AC-5 does not have enhancement. All right, so now let's look at the control requirement simplification. This control is to make sure that one user does not have the ability to carry out all mission critical activity within an environment by themselves, right? But what is the benefit of separation of duty? Separation of duty addresses any potential for misuse and abuse of authorized access and helps reduce the risks of malevolent activity without collision. So here, the without collision meaning you have to get in touch or you have to connive or collude with somebody else in order for you to achieve your malicious intent. But if you are by yourself, there is no way you can achieve that. This is what this control is enforcing. But it does not address the collision. So if someone is in charge of account payable, and then collude or connive with the person in charge of account payment authorization, and then they defraud the company, that is possible. This control might not be able to check that because it is actually two people doing that. That is what this is saying. You have to be able to collude with somebody in order for you to circumvent this control. All right, so now let's look at control assessment approach for AC-5. To ensure this control is in place and functioning as intended, that is the design and functional effectiveness, we do the following. Number one, as always, obtain and examine the access control policy and procedure, the -1 control. Two, obtain and examine system security plan, the SSP, always important, just so you understand exactly what is stated in the implementation statement of this control. Number three, review the mission critical activities of the organization that needs to be separated. Obtain the access control SOD metrics and review to make sure no one person has the responsibility of performing a mission critical activity that needs separation. How do you do that? You have to see what the organization, you know, deem or identify to be crucial roles that should not be conducted by a single person. That will be documented in the SOD metrics. These metrics will tell you the roles or the responsibility that should not be given to one person. So once you identify the metrics, you review that to make sure that, okay, I know that role A should not be combined with role X. Right. So when I'm reviewing the roles that were created, if I see that somebody has role A and also role X, then that's a problem because in the metrics it's saying that you cannot combine role A and role X. That is an example of how you check this SOD metrics. If separation of duties cannot be enforced, a valid reason should be documented and a compensating control must be put in place. Right. So, for instance, if because of maybe budgeting reason, financial constraint, lack of the resources is forcing an organization to hire one person to do account creation and also in charge of what the audit logs and, you know, administering the audit logs and stuff like that, like we mentioned before, then there should be a compensating control in place, meaning a supervisor should be able to review and approve any log deletion by the admin, by the admin. So if the admin triggers a delete of the log, he cannot do that by himself unless a supervisor approves the logs to be deleted. So this level of approval can serve as a compensating control to having one person doing account curation and also administering the audit log functions. He cannot delete the audit log function by himself unless he goes through an approval or a workflow that requires a supervisor or a manager to approve the deletion of the logs. That will be the compensating control. Number six, ensure developers do not have access to the production environment. Because if developers have access to the production environment, it means that they can actually code something into the production environment to circumvent any control that you may have. So developers having access to production is a no-no. These are some of the areas that you should review or you should take note of when you are reviewing the separation of duties control, that is the AC-5. All right, that's it for this episode. Our next episode will be on AC-6, list privilege. If you find this video valuable, please subscribe and hit the like button so the YouTube algorithm can expose these videos to a lot of people. And I will see you in our next episode.